Hello and welcome to this second in the series of webinars that St. Paul's Institute for Communication Education has organized. We had the first one yesterday, which was generally speaking about the overview of employment situation in post-COVID and COVID times. And today onwards, we are going to speak about the specific aspects of communication. The first one, that is the second in the series today, is about PR, impact of COVID on PR industry as such. And we have brilliant speakers as our panelists. I'll introduce each one of them one by one. First, we have Atul Dubey.
Hello.
Atul has almost 4 decades of experience in communication industry and is currently senior partner with RK Swamy BBDO. He has an ideal combination of financial communication, teaching, administration, operations, and management. His knowledge and experience in BFSI sector is tremendous, as he has handled large institutions like State Bank of India, Reserve Bank of India, NABARD, UTI, SIDBI, IDBI, and so on. He is a visiting faculty at SNDT Women's University for postgraduate courses in media and communication, and is with RK Swamy from July 2013 onwards. Then we have Candice D'Cruz. She is the vice president. Candice is responsible for developing and leading the management and marketing of Marriott International's luxury portfolio that consists of 8 of the world's most coveted hospitality brands. Candice is a true believer that travel defines us more than our nationality, and often turns to her young daughter for inspiration on how to cater to the new generations of ever-demanding luxury consumers who are rewriting the industry outlook. Candice started her career with leading PR agencies like Ogilvy, Public Relations Worldwide, and Weber Sandwick. Currently residing in Dubai, Candice has voted number one in the 2019 Hotelier Middle East Power 25 Women Leaders in Hospitality. Wow, Candice. And ranked amongst the top 50 storytellers of the region by Forbes Middle East for 2020. That speaks highly of you, Candice. Then we have Glenn D'Souza. Glenn has been with MSL in India since 2000. He heads the crisis communication mandate for the group, as well as the national media portfolio. He is part of a team that has developed various crisis preparedness modules and managed issues and crises for some of the largest healthcare, ONG, automobile, and aviation brands in India, while implementing various countermeasures to safeguard their interest. Passionate about health and aviation, he has worked closely with leading pharma and aviation conglomerates and supported global delegate visits of 20-plus Fortune 100 companies. At MSL, Glenn has managed the India campaigns of various heads of states, president of South Africa, mayors, London, senior bureaucrats, South Africa and France, emirs at UAE, and various state governments. He leads a team of experts across India, which overlook outreach and engagement efforts across 35-plus cities and towns, whose strong understanding of our vibrant consumption landscape is key to success of any campaign. And I am Alpana Killawala. As the head of communications department at the Reserve Bank of India for 36 years, I was responsible for designing the entire range of communication of the central bank. I'm now working as an independent advisor in corporate communication, and I'm also chairperson of the PRSI Mumbai chapter and moderator for today's webinar. So let's begin. Let me start with Glenn, who's handling multiple clients who are important in current situation, aviation, pharma, ONG. So Glenn, how's work?
Good evening. Good evening, everyone. And good evening to all who just joined in. Interesting question, Alpana. And I'd like to quote someone very senior from the industry who made this comment about a week ago when I was on one of the other panels, who said that, you know, it's always business as unusual. And why I say unusual is because every day is a new day. It's a new chapter for us. And it's not only challenging for the brands that we work with, but it's also challenging for the industry that we work in, which is communications. It's not only PR, it's advertising, it's digital. Because what we are seeing today is something that has never happened. And I was just looking at a few reports which McKinsey came out with just last week. In fact, I think it's one of the best periods to be in this business, which is about communications and PR. Because the kind of investments that CEOs are looking at, I'm not only talking about the communication industry, but I'm talking about the entire brand universe. The investment in technology has leapfrogged at least 5 times or 5 years in advance. So we are doing things today that we should have ideally been doing maybe 3 or 4 or 5 years later. And I think that's one of the best learnings about being in this profession today. Is we're going to be leapfrogging into the future even faster than we could think about. And I think that is why I'm really, really excited. And obviously, like my portfolio says, it's all about prices. And it's a great time to support brands because they look at your partners, your communication partners, for a lot of help and support. And it's our job to ensure that we play the right.
So I think similar to Glenn, I will say it's been an interesting few weeks for us in hospitality. For us, the core of our business is built around people. Our associates are those who sort of drive experiences and deliver experiences. In fact, are key at making people dream. So our industry kind of thrives on people and people interaction. With COVID-19, we've been forced to sort of close down on many of our hotels globally. We've pretty much paused all interaction with people, and we've stopped what I say in terms of creating lifetime memories. What we have seen over the last few weeks is one area that we've embraced in a big way is technology and all things technology. I would say we've gone from an industry that has been so reliant on people interaction to now being completely reliant on technology as the main source of communication. For instance, for myself, typically I tend to travel about 40 to 50% of my time visiting markets and visiting hotels and meeting our teams on property, whether it's an existing property looking to reposition, it's a new property that's going to open doors soon. So really getting them ready for when they open doors or when they're sort of changing their stance. I've had to completely stop all of that interaction, even with my own team based out of Dubai here where I'm based in London. I've had no interaction, no physical interaction with them besides digital platforms like today, Zoom and Microsoft Teams. So it's I will say for an industry that thrives on people interaction, it has been quite a interesting chapter for us to focus on interaction through and to be able to sort of show and exchange emotions through video. One thing that's come out of this is no doubt our meetings have gotten shorter. Where we would typically do maybe an hour meeting, we're doing that in 30 minutes. So they're quite focused and almost laser focused on what we want to say. But what's come out of it is our days have become longer. Because we seem to be doing a lot more meetings, a lot more around the clock, and a lot more interaction with people. And I'd say the new focus has kind of been over-communicating with us wanting to make sure that we're aligned. So my day has been a lot more communication that I were over video or emails than I would have typically done, because I would have done that in person over a coffee or a lunch, which has kind of changed in the last few weeks.
Yeah, it's more business-like probably now.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Let's get back to Atul and see whether he's technically...
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, much better.
Okay. No, what I was saying is that in January, February, everything was going very smoothly, and suddenly, you know, in March, this was almost thrust upon us and nobody was prepared for it. But I think these 2 months have been a real learning process for all of us, for the seniors, juniors, mid-level, even for our bosses, everyone. It has been a learning period because And that's what I think all human beings are about, because we learn to adapt to crisis so well, and especially in the communication, when everything was shut, the only thing that was working was communication, whether it was telephonic, whether it was internet, whether it was communication that was ruling the day. And I think it's been a great learning period these 2 months for all of us in the communication business.
Definitely. And always communication has been the key to any crisis for that matter. And like in one of the conversations, you were saying, Glenn, that, Candice, that communication always takes precedence over all other management functions.
Absolutely. In a crisis, I think communication and messaging, I would say, sort of leads the way, just to make sure that everybody is sort of singing from the same hymnal. In a crisis, I think you go back to basics and make sure that you know what your core message is, and everybody at least the C-suite is saying the same top down and externally.
Right. So let's see how the challenges have been for the PR industry in this lockdown period. Glenn, can we hear from you?
So I wouldn't call it a challenge. I think the only challenge, and I think Candice brought that out, is its contact. Okay, if we're not having a lot of contact with our people, with our teams, or with even our clients. And that's, I'm talking about physical contact. So it's all about contactless communication. I wouldn't call it a challenge, but I would actually call it, what's the right word? I think it's an opportunity. Now, let's look at what happened in 2009 during the financial meltdown. The agencies, the brands that survived the 2009 financial meltdown are the ones that are doing extremely well today. And I think in our industry or in the business that we're in today, if you can pass or get out of this really, really strong, you're really going to be in a place which will have a lot of value. Now, when I talk about brands or about communications, I think the agencies or the professionals who do well now will find this industry to be the most prolific, if not the best place to be in, because you're going to be thinking beyond what you usually think about. You're going to be interacting on platforms that you never thought you'd be interacting. Okay, you're going to be looking at thought processes which will not only encompass profitability, but it will also encompass people, and it will also encompass the planet. And that's why we call it the 3P process, because in the old days, brands would always think about profitability. That's why you would hire a communication agency. Today, brands are looking at not only profit first, but it's actually people first. The people you're dealing with, your consumers that you're dealing with. And finally, what are you doing for the planet? I mean, the environment that you work in. So these are the new P's, the 3 P's that have actually evolved. And the brands that do well, exceptionally well in this space, and are the ones who are going to be using the right communication partners, the right creative team, the right digital environment. And hence I say it's not a challenge. I think it's an opportunity to go beyond the usual brief. It's a great opportunity. And I think, and that makes me excited every morning that I get up, and I believe, and I agree with Candice that, you know, our days are growing longer and longer. For some reason, you know, that's something that I don't like, because I had a lot of time traveling between office and home or meetings, and you had a lot of personal space. But right now, there's a lot of focus. There's a lot of great focus. And I think the thought process is actually in overtime. But the results that I see are even better. Okay? And that's why I call this as an opportunity, not as a challenge.
Glenn, you need to be a little louder, because... Most of what you're saying, at least I couldn't hear. I don't know about others. I guess you spoke about challenges being converted into opportunities.
Yep.
So let's ask Candice, because hers is the most challenging of the jobs in the current situation.
Yes, I think everybody knows that the hospitality industry or I'd say travel and tourism at large has been hit the worst when it comes to COVID-19 and the entire pandemic and what's happened around the world. I guess in a situation of crisis from a corporate side, in terms of my profile, we've got two sort of environments or two key stakeholders that we need to be communicating to. One is the internal set of stakeholders as well as external. Now, while the core message pretty much would remain the same, and I hope for many corporates it remains the same, because you want to be saying the same to your internal people who are key sort of in a phase of a crisis. The tactics and the frequency between the two possibly changes. Now, when it comes to internal communication, I think communication between employer and employee is pivotal to finding successful outcome during a crisis. And it's true to any crisis, whether like Glenn referred to the economic crisis back in 2008, 2009, or today when we're talking about coronavirus, communication has been key. What has been interesting, and I'd say a challenge for an industry like ours, is how do you do that with social distancing? How do you maintain messaging when we are a people's driven industry? When we are, it's all about face-to-face communication. How do you ensure that you are being able to get across that empathy while sort of ensuring that they're up to speed with what's happening around the world? So that's on the internal side in terms of what I call as over-communicating, what I referred to earlier, which has been the new norm for us to ensure that our associates are up to speed. Because of the sheer fact that each market is so localized, and each market, our strategy has had to be very localized. Right. It's absolutely not cookie cutter, and it's absolutely not one size fits all. It's almost getting to the level of uber personalization. So when it comes to external stakeholders, I feel quite blessed. We have an amazing communications team who have pretty much been working around the clock, being able to localize based on local market needs, whether it's around lockdown, whether it's around curfew, whether it's around cleanliness standards, whether it's around even cases being found in some areas of hotels, and being able to deal with it. Because when people are at the core of any crisis, empathy sort of has to take over more than anything else. You have to put yourself in their shoes and sort of say, how would I react if that was the case? So we've had to be very vigilant when it comes to both external and internal communications. And each day has been a learning curve. One thing COVID-19 has taught us is there is no playbook. Every day is a new day, and every day you're sometimes sort of recreating your framework. There is a baseline. We all, having dealt with crises before, we know that there's a basic framework of what you would do in a crisis situation. But with COVID, with it being so fluid and sort of changing based on markets, we've had to pretty much think on our feet. So every day we've learned a new thing. And I think our generations to come will learn a lot more as we progress and sort of move ahead out of COVID-19.
Yeah, quite right. Atul, you have been working with financial clients, and unlike challenges that Glenn and Candice are facing, your challenges would be quite different, because you are working with regulator, you're working with other financial big conglomerates. How has been a challenge for you?
The first challenge was that because every financial institutions needs an interface. People, despite the push in the earlier years, for the last 6 years, there has been a lot of push to move to digital payments and all that. People were a little lethargic. People were a little scared also that, you know, something might go wrong, frauds might happen. So one had to strike the right balance that, yes, you can, you have to shift, because there was no option. Your back was against the wall if you wanted to do transactions. So everybody now started downloading Paytm, Google Pay, all the payment apps that were there. You'll find almost every payment app, because some vendors were having some other different payment apps. So that was one. Communication was very, very important. And yet at the same time, as a regulator, RBI had to tell them that be safe, be, you know, do even the RBI governor, whenever he speaks nowadays, every time he gives the message that go digital, but play safe. So that is the communication was very, and across the board, even LIC, for example, LIC is one of our clients, there also the communication had to be that come and buy your thing, come and pay your installment. People are scared, oh, my policy due, what am I going to do and all that. So that had to be kind of, don't worry, you know, giving that assurance of the people that nothing, world has not come to an end, world will go on, that is the financial business will go on as usual. RBI is working very diligently, you know, with a team of 200 people, and so were LIC and large institutions. So life was difficult, but it was still not stopping. Everything would go on as it is with a little bit of difficulty. So that was a big challenge to communicate during this period.
Yeah, and I suppose things or results come in faster in crisis times. So. Yeah. Because you have to deliver in that sense.
It's a tipping point.
Yeah. I remember when I was at the RBI, we used to push for social media more and more, that we should use social media more for our messaging and all. And it used to take its own sweet time to come back to us. And now I see that they are doing a lot more on social
media. Yeah, correct.
Twitter and Facebook and all this.
Yeah.
It's a kind of good opportunity, I would say.
Yeah.
Candice, you also spoke about something that there is no playbook, and we are sort of inventing and rewriting the rules altogether afresh, given the situation, which is ever evolving still. So, can you tell us about some examples where you have used new kind of strategy or tools or something?
I guess going back to what I also mentioned, that every corporate does have their own framework when it comes to a crisis and how we work within the framework. So we do have that. We have that as a baseline of who is the face in times of crisis. In our case, it's very centralized. We have our global CEO, Arnie, who took to video. He is a cancer survivor, and if you see that video, if you've not seen it, you should. It's a video that really shows how much of our culture is based around people first. This is our mantra. Everything that we do is about people first. So even in terms of a crisis, whether it was us having to make our global teams and our C-suite executives having to make tough decisions of putting our teams on furlough, this has been communicated from the very top. Now, when we're moving into our recovery phase, where we're seeing some markets slowly open up and we're adapting to those changes, the reason I spoke about no playbook is we don't know what we need to do within those markets. We don't know what are the guidelines when it comes to cleanliness and safety. Again, this is all around people. This is all around being able to make people feel confident to step into an environment. We often joke about it. You are spending money to sleep with us. Now, when it comes to a situation when there's crisis and when there's health and when we know that there are dire situations to it, how much more do we need to give you that assurance that when you stay with us, you are absolutely safe? And how much more do we have to make sure that that playbook, our associates around the world who have different levels of being able to communicate. I mean, we're dealing with the language barriers, and that's why when you look at in this situation, going back to the fact that we've got to go back to basics, work within basic framework, but also think on our feet, is you don't have the ability to sort of show in person what you would. Gesturing is such a big part of communication, going back to basics in terms of communicating to a person. That's completely gone. You are now relying on voice and you're relying on video. In some cases, yes, you can. But we would really have to think of how do we do that for our associates? How do we give them assurance that even in their interactions, they're going to be safe? So while we are making sure that our messaging is we're vigilant when it comes to our external guests and helping them dream again. I mean, we're in a phase where we're saying I'm lucky or I'm fortunate enough to work on some brands like Ritz-Carlton, St. Regis, W, that typically are covers of the most glamorous magazines. So we're saying you will travel again. We will travel again. And the sure fact that when we're giving people the opportunity to dream for later, but between now and then, we're ensuring that whatever we do when it comes to our messaging and whatever we do for our employees to get ready for when we welcome them needs to be airtight. It needs to be secure enough for them to come and stay with us again.
Right. So as I take it from you, brand is taking a backseat probably, and the customer, the audience, the target audience becomes more important probably. Glenn, does it work with you as well?
Well, I think that's the overall aim of most brands that we represent. It's, and if you see what's happening right now, for the first time in the last 3 months, or you know, which is pretty early in the year, we have campaigns from brands which is actually no sell and no show, in the sense that most of the brands today are not selling anything. Look at the campaigns across all verticals, be it PR campaigns, be it advertising campaigns or digital campaigns. We are all talking about, we want to be with you. Okay, we understand your hardships, but ultimately we need to be safe. Okay. And whenever the time is good, we'll come back together. Okay, so most brands today, and that's what we're communicating. We're saying, we're not here to sell. We want to be with you. You are our customers and we want to be part of your environment. And I think that's a learning that I've not seen in many, many years. Every brand, you name the brand in the country today. Okay, there are brands that have actually moved from their traditional source of business, be it alcohol brands making sanitizers. Today, I've heard of a brand which actually makes wood, okay, plywood. They're getting into something which is not even sanitizers. It's something that kills germs. So, and that product was with them for the last 20 odd years, but they never marketed it. Today, they saw a need and they're actually going to move towards that. So, like I said, these are brands that we work with, and it's our job as communicators to basically bring out that key message as to why we're doing this. There is an objective behind it, is that we need to be with our customers or our clients at good times or bad. And we are always there to support. So I think that's the key message that, that everyone wants to talk about. And I think it's a great change from only making money. Like I said, the three P's have changed. It's no longer profit. The bottom line is not profit. It's profit, people, and then the planet that we work or we live.
Right. You were better in audibility right now than earlier, but you still can be better. Okay. Maybe you could bring the mic closer to you.
I think I'll,
Words are getting lost.
I'll have to yell a bit.
Yeah. What I could gather perhaps is you were also talking about the brand and how brand is taking a backseat in pharma industry. I remember this advertisement which is coming on the television right now, where one sabun is advertising for itself, but it says koi bhi sabun se haath dhoye, lekin haath dhoye. And then they, at the end of it, they display the brand. So absolutely, that's the kind of messaging that people are looking at probably. And that is where I think at PR is taking over communication in advertisement. So people are rebalancing the communication in favor of PR rather than communication. What do you say, Atul?
So time immemorial, PR and advertising has always worked together, because there are some things which advertising can do, which PR cannot do, and there are some things PR can do, which advertising can do. But I think the balance has shifted more towards PR and digital in the last 2 months, because physical advertising was not there. You know, above the line advertising was almost nil because newspapers were not being distributed. Television, people couldn't shoot commercials. Whatever was there that they were running, but there were problems that people didn't want to spend on that. But at the same time, PR took a front seat for some time, and clients wanted to communicate about what they were doing, which they never did. Like, people were sanitizing. LIC wanted to show to the world that they were sanitizing their office. Other banks wanted to show that they are sanitizing. They are following all the, you know, social distancing protocols. Everything they are following, to that their customers are safe, and to show themselves as very responsible people. And we, at the same time, they were also doing CSR, which they were communicating that they were, you know, funding ambulances, they were feeding the people, community work, they were doing, you know, various kind of organizations were doing all kinds of work. So, and that communicating to us, because somewhere they wanted, didn't want to lose that opportunity that, yes, we are good human beings, we are good citizens of the country also. And when it comes to the crunch, we always are there to help out the nation in any way. People have donated large funds also to the PM Care Fund. And that is also something which they have put on social media, on PR also, that we have donated so much. Not to TomTom, but yet show them to the customer that, yet, we are responsible. So if you trust us as a brand, this is what your brand is all about.
Okay.
And that was a very good message I think they got, they were able to get across.
Quite right. In fact, the next question is, I'll take one question from the audience. There is Sakshi Prasad, who is asking something about what we spoke a question earlier. She says that talking about social media, how has it helped certain industries in growing during the pandemic, particularly industries which were not more active on their social handles. And RBI is a very clear example there.
Yeah.
So would you like to say something there, Atul?
Yes, in fact, on both sides, on the client side also, in fact, certain clients didn't have, not very active on their social media handles. There's some, and they were not there on all the social media, like Instagram was a fairly recent addition. So many clients were not on social media. Suddenly everybody had, you know, was calling us up and telling us, you know, please create a social media handle for us. Please do a new cover page for us. So many financial institutions which were using social media only for their products and services suddenly shifted to some many other things also. And they started using across the board all social media channels. We largely handle even a brand like a fertilizer brand, which, you know, one would think that farmers wo kya unko social media se kya lena dena, but the amount of communication, because harvest time was coming and we had to communicate to the farmers. We have a brand called Zuari, so we did the amount of communication we did on social media with the farmers, and surprisingly the farmer community is so well connected on WhatsApp, it's not funny.
Yes.
And we were able to connect with them, send them the message of social distancing, you know, that our shops are open, please come, but please follow protocol, sanitize yourself, all that thing. Everything was communicated. There was no other advertising at all. So many of these companies were able to, you know, build on their social media and suddenly realize and then capitalize on it.
Yeah, actually, it's a misnomer to think that poor people are not connected, you know.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
I have this example of my maidservant who is gone to her gown on the second day of this lockdown. And the other day she called up to say that a lot of people are migrating from Mumbai to her gown. And I said, are you keeping them separate, quarantine and all? And she said, yes, we are keeping them in quarantine. She used the word quarantine. So we all feel that they are not connected and they don't know, but they do.
Yeah.
How about Glenn? Glenn, do you have any such experience with your clients?
No. I think Atul brought up. No, I think Atul brought up a very valid point when it came to farmers, and we've been also fortunate to work with a global brand where we actually used influencers amongst farmers. Now, who would ever believe 5 years ago that there were farmers who were influencers? Now, these were children of farmers who have studied abroad, came back to India and wanted to support the family, use modern techniques, modern fertilizers, you know, using all of their knowledge. And we actually helped build about 15 to 20 of those influencers. We were amazed at the kind of response that they got. We've realized that, you know, apart from farmers getting information on what is the right seed, what is the fertilizer, or maybe what is the weather pattern or the cost of their crop, but they also needed to connect. And these influencers created a hell of a racket, because, and a very positive racket, because that's something that we never expected to have. So we always think that, you know, social media or communication is only part of the big metros. It isn't the fact. It's moved beyond the metros. The e-commerce revolution in India talks only of that. The growth has been exponential. Social media growth. If you look at TikTok, the kind of videos that are being made is not made in metros. They're all made in rural India. And that's how they're growing. So I think as we and as we pass these 3 months in under COVID, we've seen more and more of that increasing. I was just trying to get my hand on some data on the growth of certain patterns, and there's only data up to March. But there's been about a 50% growth in Instagram, as well as in Instagram and Facebook, when it comes to people spending more time on it. The number of times TikTok and Instagram has been downloaded has grown 50 times, all right, in the last 1 month itself. That shows that, you know, people are adopting to digital. And basically, as part of the PR industry, we also have to adopt it. And change is inevitable. We have to use it. And my earlier comment on we've moved what we were supposed to do 5 years ahead, we are using it now, only shows that we are in a great place. We're in a great place, and this industry is only going to boom.
Yeah.
Atul, you want to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to add to what Glenn said, that, you know, with geo-targeting possible, because in India, different crops are grown in different regions. So at the same time, we were able to communicate to a farmer in Maharashtra with a different message, Karnataka in a different message, you know, UP is with a different message, Telangana. So everything, you know, the client was so happy that, you know, he could communicate to a different sets of farmers in different states with a different message at the same time.
Yeah, goes back to what I said. We are in a phase of uber personalization. Without which, I don't think a brand or a company can come out successful on the other end, because you cannot have the same messaging across the board. And more so when you know that someone is at risk.
Quite right. And social media allows a lot of slicing and...
Absolutely. Speak to me at the power of one. That is the way forward when it comes to social media. You can speak to the person literally based on what he or she likes and wants to consume.
Right. In fact, we all spoke about PR, and earlier PR were used only to communicate CSR activities, and now PR is slowly replacing, at least in the current time, advertising. There's a question from Kiran Dalani. She wants to know, or maybe he, would request you to put some light on CSR integrated with PR. Can you throw some light on it?
So perhaps I can take one of those. So, and related to COVID, we have plenty of examples from the sheer fact that we are the world's largest hospitality operator, 7,000 hotels around the world. But in time of COVID, we've been, I will say, one company, going back to what Glenn said a little earlier, we've tried to stay away from being seen as a commercial company or one that's taking advantage of the situation. We've tried to make sure that empathy leads the way. And some of the work that we've done, we've even not gone out and spoken about it. We today work with governments across many markets where some of our hotels are used as quarantine destinations as people go back, travel back to their country, travel back to their parents, or parents traveling to their children, depending on the situation, where our hotels have been those 14 or 15 day quarantine destinations. So we've worked really closely with the tourism authorities, the governments, to make sure that we were a reliable partner without having to talk about it. I believe the success of CSR, a large part of the success is community engagement. You don't need to go out and do a press release. You don't need to take to social media all the time. Basics, going back to basics, word of mouth. I mean, if you go back to PR itself, it all started with word of mouth. Word of mouth still very much is a very powerful weapon when it comes to a situation like this. And we've been very reliant on our communities and our people, whether it's our associates or our guests who've stayed with us, to make sure that they go and tell those stories and they go and spread the word for us. While our hotels remain empty in some cases because of the fact that travel has pretty much been on pause, we've seen a lot of our hotels finding ways to be able to communicate, whether it's lights on the exterior of the buildings in shapes of hearts, on shapes of messages saying stay home. We've seen our hotels on their own do a lot. Now, even sort of at the risk of being able to, at the risk of interacting with someone who has the virus, we've had our frontline associates go into communities, whether it's meals, whether it's helping the healthcare warriors in a time of need. We've done all of this. I think what I'm trying to get at is it's not necessary when you are doing any activity which has a community engagement outlook that you need to push it out with messaging. You can get the word across without having to scream out with a press release or with social content. Go ahead, Glenn.
Simple. I think what Candice is trying to say is that people have done stuff. You don't have to get out with a press release. It's there. If you want to see what work brands have done, simple. On the very first day, I think it was the 1st of April or the first week of April, I think Parle G, with biscuit brand, that came out with this small initiative on their Twitter handle that said that we are giving out 2 crore packs of biscuits to the poor. It followed suit immediately with automakers. There are brands that didn't have their plants working. They have supported hospitals. There were brands that needed PPE equipment. None of these guys went out with a press note. They actually used their social tools, their earned platforms. So today, communication has moved away from the push to have a look at what we're doing on our earned platforms. It's all out there. There's not been a single newspaper in this country since April till even yesterday or even today that has not written a story on CSR done by a brand. All that is PR.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So that is still leading. The COVID news has a large component of CSR. And people expect you to do it. It's not something that I'm doing it because of the 2% that I have to pay the government. No, it is your right today. You have to do it. You don't have a choice, because this is giving back to community. Like I said, and I keep coming back to the three things. It's critical, because a simple brand like Asian Paints made such a big announcement that no one will forget his name. He said that he's not going to reduce staff. He's not going to cut. In fact, he's increased salaries. Today, he is the poster boy of India. And I think those are the kind of stories which there was no interview done. Remember, this was an internal communication that went out, then everyone saw it, and that's when media made ensure that it's on front page of every newspaper.
Yeah.
So the fact remains that this is all PR. Ultimately, it's just communicating. You can do it through a press release, which is not required in today's environment. There isn't much news out there anyways. The New York Stock Exchange just opened out today. It was shut for 2 months. I always thought it was shut for a week, but it was shut for 2 months. And they still got the news, right? They didn't do a press conference for that. So the fact remains that, you know, if you're doing good work, you will get the publicity that you need.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, let's also try and look at a little, because now it looks like, this lockdown has to someday go away and things slowly will move back to normalcy. Not as normal as previous times, but whatever is the new normal to that extent. And there's an interesting question that somebody has asked. He calls himself anonymous attendee. How are all of you planning to deal with mass recession that is going to take after? Isn't there a possibility of brands getting affected by that? So since you deal with multiple brands, Glenn and Atul, I'll leave this question to you.
Atul?
See, that is part of every person who's in the industry knows that there are cycles which you must overcome. And you plan for those cycles. It's not even the share market goes through cycles. Similarly, the brands also go through cycles. So there is going to be recession. There is going to be things. But there's always hope. And people, Indians are such good innovators that they'll find a way to turn the corner sooner than later. And that is what I think there is hope in everybody's heart that, yes, there is going to be some problem. It's going to take some time. But the thing is that consumers are not going to stop consuming. They might, the wallet adjustments might happen. The FMCG basket might change. But yet, people are going to have changed their values. You know, health and fitness is going to be more important for people because they realize that those who are fit are not getting affected more. So those kind of changes are going to happen. But yet, brands will be there. So people will cater to those needs. And advertising or communication or marketing is always based on a need. It is not driven by the company. So people will adapt themselves. Companies will also adapt to what is required by the consumer. They will change their brand portfolio to a certain degree to meet those demands of the consumers as they go along. It's going to take a time, but I think they have all experienced people.
It can happen quite quickly. I know of three large, very large manufacturers who have quickly moved into manufacturing PPEs in the need of the country, and they have produced in mass. So adaptability can be much quicker than what you and I can think of. And don't forget still that apart from this switching over, India is a huge, huge domestic market. So we are not so much dependent on exports as many other countries are. And domestic demand can revive the economy quite quickly if we do the things right way.
See, the fact remains that we have to all now change the narrative that we are in. We are currently in a narrative of the number of cases, the number of deaths. You know, we are in that flux right now. The narrative that the Indian brands are now looking at is what happens next? You know, how will we live with COVID? Because if you look at a vaccine, it's about 18 months, maybe a year, 18 months, 2 years away. But I think brands are also innovative. All of these brands that have been in this country are not brands that have grown up in the last 5 years. They've seen markers, they've seen cycles, and they've seen headwinds. The fact is that each of the brands that we are talking to are actually looking at the next 90 days. Now we have COVID, you don't have a choice. How do you work with it? How do you live with it? So the strategies are changing. So you may have suffered a loss, maybe in the last 2 months, that's enough time for any brand to relook at their strategies. But unless and until the brands change their narrative, you know, this is going to get only better. And I can see that, you know, and we're a country of entrepreneurs. We are not a country which is very capitalistic in nature, but it's all about entrepreneurs. We are all SMEs. And the SMEs are the growth engine of this country. And yeah. RBI, no matter what, will always talk about SMEs first.
Yeah, right.
They're always focused on the SMEs. And the SMEs yeah. have the best opportunity to jump out of situations like this.
Quite true. And in India, we have huge, huge entrepreneurial spirit.
Absolutely.
Hopefully, yeah. we should reboot quite fast.
I think if I have to sort of summarize, when we talk about the way we want to reskill ourselves and sort of look at the future, we constantly, the mantra that we're using just now is unlearn, relearn, innovate, and adapt.
That was going to be my next question. How are we reskilling ourselves?
Yeah, so for us, we've pretty much, Atul said, it's down to knowing that survival of the fittest when it comes to healthiness and how fit you are and what your health habits is going to help you or hold you in good stead as you go into the future. So for us, in terms of adaptability and speed of adaptability is going to be key. We're a big company. So for us to be able to localize and make sure that it works in that local market, whether it's relearning how we do dining, whether it's relearning how we do check-in, whether it is about absolutely looking at that contactless access to a guest when he or she arrives at a hotel. So we're probably in the next phase already in terms of living with COVID or opening hotels with COVID and what needs to be done as we see some of the markets already opening up. And we've had to very quickly look at innovation when it comes to digital and technology, as well as what do we do from a cleanliness and safety standpoint.
Yeah, and how about reskilling ourselves in communication or PR?
Well, I think it's pretty clear. I think we've been using the best tools available in the market today. It was a little tedious in the beginning, but I think we're all adapting. And as PR professionals, I think technology is the best part that could happen to us. Okay. We talk about borderless economies. I think technology is the only thing that has brought us together. And right now, if you look at Ding Talk, which is in China, like a Zoom that we have out here, I was just reading a report today. Those guys have a Zoom network or a VC network, which also translates as you speak into 20 different languages, which is unbelievable. That's technology amazing. For you. So I work with a network that has 137 offices and I do speak to my China office at least once a week. The fact remains that, you know, language is a barrier. And the minute I start using Ding Talk, I can speak in my language, they can speak in theirs. I'm getting it translated on the spot. And that's the beauty of this entire COVID experience. I think that's one learning that I don't have to travel to any country. And I used to travel once, at least 15 days a week.
Getting signals from the institute that time is getting up.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
One few last, let's say 2 minutes each from each of you on what will be your advice to the students who want to join up this kind of course. We'll start with Atul because he's teaching.
Again, to take a leaf out of Candice's book, that there is no playbook, there is no standard operating procedure now in communication. So while teaching to the students also must realize that they have to read as much as they can, get as much knowledge out of, you know, whatever sources are available to them. And to the teachers and to the institutions also, I would like to say that the faculty has to be of practitioners, not academicians, because this can be only taught from practice. What you learn, this kind of a crisis is not out of any book.
Right.
Even in advertising or marketing, Peter Drucker and Philip Kotler cannot teach you what has happened in the last 2 months. So you have to have practitioners teaching so that they are able to bring the outside world to the classroom and tell the student. There is a lot of opportunities which are going to come in the next couple of years for communication professionals. So as students, you must work hard, read a lot, read everything that you need. The more knowledge is power today. And the more knowledge you acquire through books and through social media and through internet and all that is really going to, you know, help you in your careers. That's all I have to say.
Glenn, what would you say? your advice to the students?
I think the biggest challenge is obviously knowledge. And with the COVID incident that's happening right now, the only thing that I can tell most students is challenge every information that you see. Because today there's going to be an answer. We didn't have an answer about a month ago, maybe 2 months ago. But learn to challenge every thought that you have, because it'll only make you better practitioners. It'll make you better communicators. Do not take any information lying down. Just because someone has done it or it may have helped a brand may not be possible to help another brand. All right. So you always have to look at it from a 360 degree view. Look at it, challenge yourself. Just check if this is the best option available. And especially in a situation which is a crisis situation, there's always going to be prospects or predictions which you'll never think of. So it's important to challenge every communication that comes to you. You know, and that's the only thing that I would like to leave back for you guys.
Yeah. Candice, you are the youngest amongst all of us, and you also have the next generation with you, your 3-year-old daughter. So yes. What is your advice to the next generation?
Yes, I do. Yeah, so I am, I mean, as you sort of said at the very start, I started my career in communications and in an agency. And I sort of took the opportunity to make sure that every time there was opportunity, I had my hand raised to say, I can learn more. So anybody who is aspiring to get into communications or even marketing at large, because as we've heard from my co-panelists, the lines have kind of gone blurred. What I will say is ace the basics. Make sure you do it wholeheartedly. If PR is for you, make sure that you're learning the basics. Make sure you're applying it and questioning it, like Glenn said, questioning what you're doing, not doing it because it's a cookie cutter approach, because you can learn theory, and that theory is absolutely important because you need to understand the framework. But how you apply that as you progress in your career is up to you. As I say, to be successful, you have to be all in. You can't do it halfway. There are no shortcuts. And I will also say, when I say shortcuts, time teaches. I might not look my age, but I have been around the block. And time absolutely teaches. So when you want to progress, make sure that you have, you're all in, you give yourself time. But most importantly, make sure you surround yourself with good people. Good people that can teach you and set you up for success for your future, because you are as good as your weakest link. For me, I have always made sure that I've had good leaders, even some bad leaders who I've learned from, saying that I don't want to be like them. But make sure that you have more good people around you to be able to take away what they have done as part of their learnings to where they have got to.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So that has been a great, great learning the past 1 hour. I can see there are some questions on the question answer board, and some of them I have taken also. We have answered during the conversation. Some which we couldn't due to paucity of time, we will make sure that we answer them offline. There were also some of them were not directly connected with this webinar. So we will definitely answer them offline. And last, what I would want to say is that this is a great initiative from SPICE, that is St. Paul's Institute of Communication Education. And tomorrow there will be a session at 4 o'clock, same time, on journalism and what are the challenges in front of journalism in this COVID-19 period. So do join in and do make it a point to learn from there. Thank you very much. And thank you, panelists, for joining in and sharing your
Thank you very much.
Our pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us. Yeah.